I will do less. More play.
Do less of what?
Canceling sessions. Because right now we have 2.5 players. I suppose because we're, it is mostly a role play session anyway. All right. Yeah, we'll do this. Trying to find some atmosphere music. All right.
I won't be able to hear it. Oh, well.
Anyways. All right. Welcome to Bears and Dragons, episode 41. What happened previously? Bears and Dragons.
Well, a new group of adventurers were gathered at the Eyes of Io compound, given a task to go up against try to get the souls back of the Pirates of Faith. We found out that they were being held by the demon lord Asmodeus. And they came up with a plan to go up against Ravikora, I keep forgetting the name.
Ravenkoros, a Incarnum dragon.
Incarnum, yeah. Because he was a servant of the Raven Queen, who right now he had gone a little kooky. So it is our job to bring him back to his senses so he can go back to the Raven Queen and we can possibly get a favor from her. Try to get Asmodeus to release the Pirate of the Faith's soul, which he did.
Well,
the Pirates of Faith.
Sure.
Did they Pirates of Faith? Or he released 6 souls. We're assuming they're the Pirates of Faith. We don't know fully because there's 10.
Yeah. So he had 6 souls. Those of Daonis, Kel and Yaros. That's 3. There were 10 people of your party.
Yeah.
He had 6 souls. You're missing one.
Bullet.
Maybe.
Boy, Frederica, Kriv, Gisley, Zen, Frederica, Ethric, Daonis.
I gave you the list in chat last night.
Tro, Frederica, Keithrick, Cyrus, Boy, Zen, Gisley, Daenerys, Kel, and Yaros.
Mm-hmm. And he had 6.
Yes. Which 6? We do not know.
Aren't the souls of the ones not from over here? Not in the lot?
So, After the matron of ravens exits the chamber, the camera seems to zoom out to this like upside down mountain view of an upside down mountain with that split into 9 layers. Zooms out further, and we start seeing essentially a map of the plains. We see it's at the bottom, and we move over to one side, and we zoom into another realm, one of dark shadow mists. We fly across a rocky landscape of dead trees, dry or really dark lake beds, and in towards a canyon of, you don't know what, you wouldn't be able to tell exactly what type of rock it is. It all, everything seems to be in the shades of black and gray, and with a few sections of white from mist or some sort of spectral, ghostly like things. It's very black and white. We arrive at a big citadel on the side of a mountain. It's oddly shaped. It's more of like a rookery. Nests and although there are still some solid buildings in there. We arrive at a place known as Raven's Roost. On the balcony of one of these sections, we find a black and gold dragon wormling alongside a massive white dragonborn. I'm bored. Black and gold wormling lays his head on his crossed forearms on the balcony's railing next to the massive white dragonborn. Rubus lays his hand on Layden's head in comfort. I know. Waiting is always the most difficult part. He returns to leaning on the railing, looking up to the dark skies as the shadow fell, searching for the expected raven. The addition of Flash sparks his and his adopted son's attention. They both straighten up in anticipation, only to realize it's just two draconic shapes coming towards them. Ribbeth slouches in disappointment. Oh, just Ravencoros. Layden pushes off the balcony and moves over to a launch area, for lack of a better word. It's an open area without a balcony or railing or anything, referred to as a dragon launch. And wait, it can't be. As the shapes draw closer, the young dragon recognizes the other dragon flying with Ravencoros. Jadant! Layden leaps into the air, flying to meet up with his brother. Layden, damn it, boy! We were told we're not supposed to be flying around. Rubus runs after and leaps into the sky after him. Layden? Oop! The black incarnum wormling is air tackled by his brother into a hug. What are you doing here? Ravencoros stops to hover and watch the brothers' reunion. Krebus flies up next to him. I'm sorry, Ravencoros. I tried to stop him, but before I knew it, he'd already charged in this way. Incarnum dragon chuckles. No harm done. We're close enough to Raven's Roost. Boys, let's continue this in the roost. The three dragons and dragonborn fly back to the dragon launch and land. Ravencoros changing into a lithe dragonborn version of himself. The boys start chatting with each other while the dragonborn look on. After he died, his soul escaped Asmodeus' grasp and arrived here. most likely because of his Inconim heritage. My matron asked me to train him on traveling the outer planes, specifically so he can travel to Mount Celestia. Rebus lowers his head. That's equivocal. He closes his eyes and a tear rolls down his face. You shouldn't have had to. My fault. Reverend Koros lays a hand on the taller dragonborn's shoulder. Don't be sad, Krebus. This is the way of things. They must be in the place where they are able to be called back. It wasn't your fault, Papa. Krebus opens his eyes and looks down at his son. It was Tiamat's follower's fault. While the wormling scales are black and gold, Krebus still is reminded of the face of his husband. Although still teary-eyed, Krebus smiles. Yeah! I'm going to make sure Kriv and the rest are in their rightful places, and you're going to bring us back! Their trap failed. I mean, you saved us in the end. Going all glowy-eyed in the protective bubble? Sure, it didn't happen before we actually fell, but at least our bodies are safe for us to return. Oh, boys! Krebus leans down and grabs both of them into a big hug. The wormlings hug back. Krebus just breaks down and cries into both their shoulders. Reverend Koros watches and smiles as a black cloaked figure with raven hair steps up next to him. Startled, he looks to the figure, who raises a finger to her porcelain masked face to keep him quiet. They watch for a moment longer until the family parts from the hug. Krebus now kneeling in front of the boys. Frederica and Kriv should be so proud of you two and how you're handling this. They should be proud of Lemon, too, Thaden says. She's been reading up on the rituals and about how to care for the bodies until the ritual is ready. She's been talking to Cyrus whenever she can. Last time she came back from Candlekeep, she even got a polymorph talisman from the Keeper of Tomes. Rebus regards the wormlings. Yes. Yes, you're right. He stands. We'll bring them back. Ahem. The three are startled and turn to face the figure. They each straighten themselves out. She reaches into her cloak and pulls out 6 glowing orbs and displays them. Rebus smiles at the sight, looking towards one that glows a golden color. She examines the orbs and separates out 3 of them. 1 green, 1 brilliant white, and 1 red. He guides them to Reverend Koros. Reverend Koros, will you please see these delivered? Reverend Koros bows. Right away, mistress. They guide the orbs to a satchel at their side and they head towards the dragon lunch. Change back to their dragon form and fly into the sky, soon vanishing by a planeship spell. Etant, the black and cardamom wormling, sits up at attention. The Raven Queen separates 2 of the remaining orbs. Please deliver these to Bahamut in Mount Celestia. I believe Ravenkor showed you the way. Tatant's eyes widen. To Bahamut? Himself? Fear not, young one. Bahamut will be expecting you. He guides the gold and silver orbs towards Tatant. He takes the orbs, looks at them. He looks at his brother and Krebus. I'll take good care of them. Guides the orbs into his satchel and moves to the dragon lounge. He pauses and looks back, seeing Krebus with his arm around Layden. Krebus smiles and nods at him. I trust in you, boy. Tell Marishak he better come back or I'll hunt him down. Krebus gives Tratant a wink and a smile. That makes 2 of us. Layden chimes in, also smiling. He looks up at his papa, who looks down at him. They look back to Chitant and wave. Chitant waves, turns, leaps into the air, shortly after shifting out of sight. Krebus turns back, looks at the remaining orb and frowns. I might not be the smartest dragonborn, but I can still count. This is Frederica. Due to a bond with Chitant, you will remain here. As Marius did not have your friends, they have been They have been claimed by someone else. Phoebus snorts a puff of cold mist and narrows his eyes. Let me guess. Baba Yaga. He turns his head, looking around. It is perfectly safe to speak of her here. And yes, you are correct. At least that is what I was able to discern from their soul trails. Ribbis clenches his fist.
Laden, I'm taking you home.
Papa?
No, let me help!
No, it's too dangerous. Ribbis kneels down and places his hands on his son's shoulders.
I appreciate you wanting to help, but you don't understand how dangerous she is. She's an extremely powerful mage. I need you to stay safe. For Daddy.
But what about you?
They're your friends. Been through so much on your adventures. I want to help you save your friends and protect you. For Daddy.
Fate led him here. His journey with you has just begun, the Raven Queen says. Ribbis stands up and crosses his arms and frowns at Laden's.
You will listen to me and follow all of my instructions. Is that clear, boy?
Laden sits up straight.
Yes, sir. By my devotion to Bahamut, I swear to you I will stay safe and follow all of your instructions.
Phoebus examines Laden.
So be it.
Phoebus turns to the Raven Queen.
Thank you, mistress, for your assistance.
May I watch over your every step, and you find your quarry with speed. I grant you this blessing, be able to sense your friend's soul. The closer you are, the stronger you will feel their presence. However, only works should you be on the same plane. She raises her hands, and streams of silver energy flow from her hand, and into Krebus and Laden.
Thank you, mistress. Not just for your blessing, but for taking care of my husband, allies, and friends.
He turns to Laden.
Come on, boy. We're going witch hunting.
He places a hand on Laden's shoulders, mutters a spell, and vanishes. A short time later, in a completely different realm, Catherick. You hear some birds chirping. Well, you can't seem to open your eyes. It's so tired. You also hear like the rustling of like some small creatures around you. You suddenly feel like a tiny cold nose touch your face, like some sort of tiny creature was sniffing you. Then you feel some other creatures brush up against you. And then, must have been a walnut falls on your head. Just, boink, rolls off. And, hey, leave him alone. You can introduce yourselves when he's awake. Now, shoo. You hear some rustling as the creatures move off. You slowly open your eyes, and you seem to be in some sort of treehouse, for lack of a better word. It looks like either roots or branches, or I mean, you still have like wooden planks and everything. There's a couple windows, a door, and you see this tall, green, dark green half-orc. The only thing he's wearing, he's pretty burly and everything, and the only thing he's wearing seems to be some sort of long green kilt. He seems to be, like, making tea or something.
Do I have control over Catherick at the moment?
Yes, you do.
I'll walk over and ask him if I can have some.
Are you sure you just arrived here? Here, let me pour some. He pours you some tea. My name is Fang.
My name is Catherine.
Well, welcome to the Grove of Unicorns.
Where am I?
Well, you're in the realm of Maliki. Maliki, you would know to be the goddess of force. Maybe you probably didn't necessarily know that her realm in the Outer Planes was the Grove of Unicorns, but you're aware of Maliki.
Am I dead?
Yes. However, I have been told by the Incarnum Dragon that brought you that you may not be here for very long, but I've been instructed to make sure you feel welcome and comfortable. You're very welcome to explore. Mind the unicorns the first time. They can get a little feisty if you approach them too quickly.
Noted.
And you did seem to have some friends who wanted to introduce themselves.
I don't have many friends, but okay.
But you didn't feel the rabbits and squirrels and chipmunks that were investigating you?
Oh, okay.
Those friends. Yeah, dude. I'm sorry about Dubo. He's always carrying a walnut and he was on the shelf above you and accidentally dropped his walnut.
Won't keep them waiting any longer. And I'll just find my way out into the forest or woods.
Yeah, you walk out and you realize that when you walk out the door, you actually rock out onto a very, very large tree branch. You look down and, you're quite high. You do see next to the treehouse that you were in, there are some plants, and which leads to a rope on a couple of pulleys, which you see a little wooden platform tied to the rope. And it looks like it might be like some sort of like mini elevator. You can step on it and you'll go down slowly.
Okay, I will do that. I will kneel down and just observe my surroundings.
It's a beautiful forest. You hear birds of all sorts chirping. You see some various small woodland creatures running around, climbing across the trees. You do see off a little bit in the distance this head of what looks to be a horse, but there's this big horn poking out the top. It seems to be munching on some sort of leaves.
Stay away from that.
A rabbit comes up next to you.
Hello.
Starts sniffing you.
I guess you are just a bunny. What do you eat around here?
You hear a noise of the pulleys. It says, "Well, I have a bunch of food in the hut. We have various elven granola, and if you want something simple, otherwise we can do a little bit of hunting."
Was that the bunny?
No, that was a fang. It come down.
Okay.
Sorry.
But can I hear him in my head or something, or?
No, he came down after you.
Ah.
Okay. That was the pulleys, the sound of the pulleys.
Okay.
I didn't describe that correctly.
Okay.
I mean, do you have anything of preference? There are many different animals. If you want something that's meat worthy, otherwise we can find some good berries.
Oh, does it not matter if we eat the animals that are here?
No, it's just like any other place. I mean, we kill them, we get their meat, and well, they kind of appear again. It's one of the nice things. Everything is nice. It is just the only thing is, you definitely do not want to handle the unicorns. They're nice and friendly, don't get me wrong, but you know, they're a little wary of newcomers. So I can introduce you to a couple of them. Malai is very nice. Oh,
well, I wouldn't want to intrude.
That's Temzin over there. Very shy one, honestly, but so
I can relate.
Justin's downloading the Discord app and should be joining us.
Ooh, excellent.
It's just an RP thing. But tell him we don't need the map, so he can just hop on and be able to be a part of it.
Yay.
Well, I didn't really want food for myself. I was trying to make friends with the bunny, but I guess that if it doesn't really matter if the bunny is living or dead,
stab the neck of the bunny.
Stabby stab.
No, I'm not gonna kill the bunny. Not yet.
I mean,
it's gonna happen.
Honestly, the rabbits are the nice ones. I usually don't eat them, but you should see the big hares that are around here. They are a menace, and they are delicious. Hares, H-A-R-E.
Are there bears?
Bears. Oh, there are some bears. There's a family that lives in the cave, just like about a mile down the road here.
Is it okay to kill them?
I wouldn't do those ones, but there are some feral ones that are around. I don't see them very often, probably because they know I can wrestle them and just snap their necks.
So
looking up at Fang, you believe that he could do that.
There's a family of bears that I don't want to mess with.
Yeah, the three bears.
Okay. You said something about meeting unicorns?
Yes, if you'd like.
Sure. I'll attempt this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and he starts leading you through the forest. And he, while you're walking towards wherever, I mean, this is the first time you've been here. Yes. Tell me, will you respond when they call you back?
I'm sorry, I'm trying to think, what would I call them? My companions back in the living?
Yes.
World?
Yes, Raven Koros did mention that you would probably be called back.
Well, I do have unfinished business, though. Might I most likely will.
Well, in the meantime, make some friends here for when your time truly comes.
I will. Thank you.
And maybe even learn some new skills. Although, I don't know how long it will be here. And he basically leads you to a clearing where you're able to meet unicorns.
I chop all their horns off.
He would definitely be stopping you from this. It's like, no! Also, the only thing you're wearing is like a tunic and some like loose trousers. That's it.
I wasn't actually going to cut all their horns off.
Just three of them. There's just three of them.
But in the end, you get to spend some quiet time meeting with some forest friends. The Grove of Unicorns.
Can I call them the Happy Tree Friends?
Sure. Wow. If they were actually the Happy Tree Friends, that would be very interesting.
I'd pay to see that. Because then would it matter if he cut off their horns? It sound bad.
Since we're kind of waiting on, hoping that we can get a Cyrus in here. Frederica, are you able to talk? Being that you're working. Mute. I literally only have three of these seats. Back at the Raven's Roost, Frederico wakes to a creak of a door and someone stepping through and placing something on a table. She awakes to see a half-elf in dark black armor place some tea at a table, table near a bed that she's in.
I didn't hear, sorry.
That's all right. But,
can you give me, 5 minutes? I'm going on my break, so I'm going to be able to talk.
Okay. So, we could kind of take a 5-minute break while we try to reconvene here and get everybody set up, because strangely enough, Crib and Cyrus need to work with, are together.
I'm not sure exactly what, I told him he can be a part of it today if he wanted to. He's like, okie dokie, so I think he's joining. I'm not 100% sure, but we'll see.
Because if he's not, I'm just going to do it.
Who's Osiris?
Justin, Percival.
He's the
Cyrus was the mini dragon.
Mini dragon.
Oh.
Our wizard.
Oh, Cyrus. Okay. Yeah. I didn't put two and two together.
That's all right.
Okay, so technically I'm here, but I thought they were replacing me for my break, but they're not. So I'm going to try to do my best right now.
Okay. Well, that's fun. So basically you wake up to the sound of a door creaking and someone stepping through and placing a tray on a table nearby.
So, as I wake up, probably like a modern distress, I'm going to be looking ectic for Satand.
You realize that you are covered in a blanket, and you are also completely naked. And you see this half-elf man in garb, and he says, "Ah, you're awake. I have some clothes here if you need them. I'll be just outside." And he quickly steps off to give you some privacy. And it's a small chamber. It's very black, almost like obsidian looking. There's light, but you can't really tell where the source of light is coming from.
It's just ambient light?
Yeah. There is a window, but it looks like as if the room was still had like there was a lamp or something in the room and lit up, but there is no lamp. He's got distracted.
Wind, you can continue with someone else in the meantime if you want.
Okay. So just to kind of give you an idea of what's going on with in another realm, just to kind of give you a summary. Zindralov is in a... It looks like a beautiful Indian temple, to kind of describe how it looked like. And he's sitting near a lake with his trunky feet swishing in the water. And he's speaking to someone in Loxodon. And he says... I have to go back. My visions gave me. It led me on this path. Must continue it. Let's see. So basically, you kind of get the idea that Zindralov is definitely coming back.
Justin said he'll be just a moment.
Sorry, guys.
Scene I didn't write, but I can still kind of insert here as an interlude.
Sorry.
Sigils, the city of doors, has many of people travelers, that. You can almost find anything here, or anyone of any race, from any realm. Walking into the bar, a massive white dragonborn with wings is followed closely by a black and gold dragonborn, a little bit shorter than him.
Okay.
They look around the room, and the white dragonborn spots a woman drinking some wine at a corner table. He walks directly towards it and sits down.
You must be Tasha.
Yes. And what can I do for you?
I'm looking for your mother.
Well, what's it?
I don't know where she is.
Liz, I've kind of cut ties from her a long time ago.
Well, I bet you know how to find her, though.
Well, and what's it to you?
She has my friends.
Well, sorry about that.
I mean to kill her.
Oh, really?
Oh, I would love to see that. Oh, but it's in it for me. And he places a bag on the table. He takes it, opens it up, and goes, "Ooh. Well, let me help you out, Jade." Are we back to Frederica?
Yeah, I'm back.
Okay. So you were left in a dark chamber with one single window and strange ambient light with no source. And on the table is a pot of and a teacup.
I'm probably going to look around, look by the window, trying to search for my boy.
Okay. You also do have a pile. There is some basic black clothing that's available for you. Again, you're currently naked.
Yeah, well, after not finding boy, I'm probably going to put my clothes on.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a door?
Yep. Mm-hmm. The half-elf exit through it. Hello! Cyrus will be getting to you soon.
I will head out.
You open the door and you see it looks like a central chamber with a bunch of rooms and a balcony. You must be on one level of a multi-story sort of thing. And you see next to the railing looking over the center is that health elf who brought you your tea. Ah.
So,
welcome. Welcome to the Ravens of... Oh, Chetant, am I correct? He is currently on a delivery for our mistress. By the way, my name is Vaxildon.
Your mistress?
Yes, the Raven Queen.
This is all too confusing. Where am I?
You are at the Raven's Roost in the Shadowfell.
Do I recall being dead?
Yes. You could definitely tell that. I mean, based off of, like, if you take a moment to kind of feel, you don't feel like you can see yourself as being physical. You can touch things. Like, you have a lot of physical feelings, but there's something odd about it that it feels like you're not whole, or it's not an actual physical body.
Okay. BRB.
This is how you play D&D while you're at work.
Yeah, I speed through members. So, I'm gonna look at the health, and I'm gonna ask, is there, where should he, like, appear back or come back?
Ah, let me take you to the Dragon Lounge. And he leads you up to, he leads you up to some stairs, and you climb several stories until you get to a large platform balcony with some tables, a railing, and then there's a section which is cut out that it looks like a ancient-sized dragon could easily land on the platform.
Like a big kind of chitant, but just not the black one.
Yeah, well, a dragon hasn't actually landed. It's just a place. It was large enough that a gargantuan sized dragon could land on it,
And Vax says, here's the Dragon Lounge. We expect that once he returns, he should arrive here. If you would like a table, I can make sure that we get some tea or anything to eat if you would like.
Yeah, now that I think about it, I'm pretty famished. Anything should do.
And he says, please, rest. I'm sure the journey was tiring. And he goes off. Meanwhile, over Riv, you are tired. You can't seem to open your eyes at the moment. But you hear, whoa, he's huge. Not as big as you, but wow. You hear a deep chuckle.
I believe his size is referred to as gargantuan.
I didn't realize he'd be that big. Wait, where's Cyrus? You hear a couple of like footsteps. Oh, there he is, on the other side of his head. I bet Kriv or Marishat could fit him in his mouth. You hear the chuckle again. Iris looks so tiny. Much smaller than I would remember.
Despite his body and life, his soul has always been a pseudo-dragon. His form will probably change when he awakes.
Think it'd be okay if I stick around until they wake?
I believe they are waking as we speak.
And, Kriv, when you open your eye, you see popping into view this small dragon of black and kind of this combination of black and like steel blue. Emit a little bit of indigo colors. You definitely recognize this as Chitant, but he looks very small.
Would I realize right away that I'm back in my regular body, or would I still believe? Like, could I feel that I'm back in my original body?
I would say I think it would be kind of up to you, being like seeing Chitant this small. It takes a moment for you to kind of realize, be like, oh, that sort of thing.
Yeah, it's like I'm like realizing, like, kind of on reflex, like just my wings will stretch out. And then all of a sudden I'm like, wait a minute, wings. And then all of a sudden I would just realize, like, I'm back as being Marishak. So then I'll slowly kind of like get up, being mindful now of the fact that I'm back in my original body.
And Chitak goes, whoa! It kind of like ducks like right next to you quickly and picks this tiny pseudo dragon up in his paws and steps back. It's like, I just want to make sure Cyrus is okay. And he starts petting this still sleeping pseudo dragon who yawns.
Died. Or is this a more out of body? Because Kriv has experienced the fact that he's been out of body back at the Bahamut's castle in his original body. So he's trying to also kind of figure out, like, did I die? Or is this another one of those out of bodies? But it's like, then why is Chitant and Cyrus here? I am so confused. confused right now.
Yeah. You look up from Chitant and you see a much larger dragon with platinum scales just kind of like casually laying on the ground in this vast garden, which you recognize to be the garden at the Fortress of Bahamut in Mount Celestia. Bahamut says to you,
"Yes, your body did pass. But someone is expecting to call you back. And I will not interfere."
Is Trebus and Bladen okay?
Yes, they are fine. Well, at least last that I know. I haven't really been keeping track of them. Chotant showed up with you and Cyrus. Cyrus, I thought I'd be here for you. The others are currently off on errands. Apologize about that. I'm sure you would have liked to have seen them.
Meanwhile, Chitant is putting a very tired-looking pseudo-dragon into a more appropriate place to make sure that he doesn't get stepped on. And
go ahead. I'll go ahead and like nudge Cyrus. Okay, pick up.
And Cyrus, you feel this poke of a very large. Wait, do you use your claw or how do you do it?
No, I'm using my like snout, kind of just like. Wake up!
This very. You feel like this.
The claw can easily puncture him.
Yeah. this very large, like wall of scales, kind of like pokes you from the side.
Five more minutes.
Little one, it's time to wake up. Some things have happened.
What?
So you open your eyes and you look up and you see the face of Chitant. It's a really big face. It's like, did Chitant grow a lot? And then behind him is this giant a gold dragon face.
Little one, it's me.
Oh my.
Yeah.
You might want to wake up a little bit more. Your body might feel a little weird, but just think about who you are and it should change. Is that right? And you hear this deeper voice says,
"Yes. Just needs to wake up a bit and I'm sure he'll return to his size."
You kind of look around at yourself and you realize you are just a regular pseudo dragon. After a panic moment and you close your eyes and like think of how you were the mini dragon instead, and Chitant and Kriv see as this shape just kind of like broadens out and expands. You also realize that when you were talking before, vocally you were just you weren't actually speaking, but you were doing your telepathic communication sort of thing, and you end up growing to your normal mini dragon size. And Chitant now looks. And Chitant now, as that happens, Chitant now, oh no, he hasn't changed size. He was the same the last time as you last time you saw him.
Welcome to Mount Celestia, young one.
Oh,
and really? You see this
You see this platinum dragon that's bigger than this gargantuan-sized gold dragon.
Oh my gosh. Oh my. Hello, mister. Mister? Are you a mister?
I am Bahamut.
Oh, wow. Okay. Hello. You're a real jerk to my friend, you know that, right?
Yes, I was. But I was trying to teach him. And he turns back to Marishak and says, and I think you learned your lesson.
I did.
Needless to say, when your time comes, you will return here. Yeah. I am proud of you, Marishak.
I can't leave. He does not know how to respond to that. Yeah, like, it's like,
thank you. Shatant is probably just going to be like, I can't, to Cyrus, I can't wait to annoy Layden and tell him I met Bahamut.
No, he's not saying that. He seems to have gotten a slightly different personality on death, because he has currently become essentially a bearer of souls for the Raven Queen.
Oh, nice.
I could say now is not my time. I have lots of life to live with Phoebus and Layden.
And they will be calling you back. So you will only be here for a short time. Little one, we do have a very vast library. I understand that you are very interested in books.
Oh, yes, of course. It's my favorite thing.
And so he will... basically, you all end up getting a tour of his fortress, and it's essentially Mount Celestia, and you probably spend some time flying around and spending some time with Bahamut. Shatant returns to the Raven after you've woken up and you know, just kind of like, he made sure everybody was okay. Says, I better go back to Mama. She's probably worried about me. And he flies up into the air and shifts away. Frederica, you there notice a flash in the distance and a familiar black and familiar dragon flies down to the launch. He sees you at one of the tables, and he goes, Mama! And he heads on right over to you and actually kind of poofs into his boy form.
So I'll be catching him, and like, he's probably going to complain of how hard I'm going to just squeeze him.
Nope, Mom. I miss you too, Mama. Ow. Wait a minute. Egg. Why am I feeling pain? That seems kind of weird.
And she's gonna be so happy. He's back. She's just gonna fall on her knees, crying. Sister, who's always stern and not really showing emotions, but now she got scared.
And he hugs you back and he goes, it's okay, Mama. I got here before you did.
Don't do that again.
Well, Mistress wanted me to take Craven Cyrus to Mount Celestia. She thought it was appropriate that I would do it. It was a very important job. Reverend Corus showed me where to take him to. I could plane shift.
Isn't that great?
I mean, I can only go to certain places, but right now it's pretty much just between here and Mount Celestia, but I can do that.
I'm just happy. I mean, I'm sure if we were going to be staying for longer, I would learn about how to get to the other planes. But as of right now, it's just here and to Mount Celestia. That's it. But I'm excited. Although, I mean, as I said, from what the mistress told me, just for a short while we're here, as long as we answer the call back, when Krebus does the ritual, as long as we answer, we'll go back. Everything will be as it was, well, kind of, and we'll just be fine. But when the time comes, which for me might be a really long time, but when the time comes, I'll become here. Well, Mom, I'm like a year old. Dragons live for a really long time.
Well, you gotta train more. I don't want you to die sooner.
Well, I know, Mama. But you know, I'll train up and like I believe I'll get a little bit bigger when I'm like 6 years old, and just as I get older. So I'm definitely going to try to not do this whole death thing again. I don't really like it, but I found it really interesting, especially considering like when I died, I came directly here. Apparently, while in hell, the devils can claim your souls before you go anywhere else, like some sort of deal or something. And well, Asmodeus took yours, and Cyrus and Kriv and Cinderlove and Gisley. And so Asmodeus took those, but then after you know that incarnate dragon that we were supposed to be going and saving? Well a different group apparently took care of that. And Krebus and Layden. Krebus and Layden were here. And they brought them here, and they talked to the great Raven Queen, and she said she doesn't really give an expression because her face is just all like a big porcelain mask sort of thing, so I couldn't really tell, but from what I could tell, she seemed kind of angry, and she herself, she didn't like send a messenger or anything. She herself went down and talked to Asmodeus and got your souls back. And she brought him here, and she kept you, obviously, because you're here. And Reverend Corus took Gisley, Zinderlof, and Ketherick. And then she had me take Cyrus and Marishak. I mean, Kriv. I don't know. That's kind of confusing. And she had me take them over to Mount Celestia, and I stuck around until they woke up, and they're fine. They're fine. Perfectly fine. Did you know that Kriv is like he's an ancient Jin Gold dragon? He's huge.
Yeah.
It's like this big. You know what I mean.
Do you want to know something bigger than that?
What's that?
Mama kicked his ass one time.
Really? Technically, you only killed an adult version of him, but still.
Be right back. It's actually my break for once now. So,
yay! So the taunt and Vax does end up bringing some sandwiches and some food and meat and such. So we have a lovely reunion between Layden and or not Layden, Chetant and Frederica. We return to the Sanctum of Eyes, the place where the Eyes of Io have set up in the world of Toril. About a day, we've had spent the night, and everybody has had a good rest. I'm not going to say restful, because I'm sure a few of you probably stayed up a little late. But you hear the front doors of the Sanctum of Eyes open, and a familiar booming voice yells out, "Honey, I'm home!"
So we're back at the compound?
Yep.
All right.
Yeah. Krebus Delmirov Nyquil enters the mansion carrying a large burlap sack. Following him is a tall black and gold dragonborn in blue plate armor with the symbol of Bahamut emblazoned on his chest plate.
Papa, how late did we become a dragonborn?
Watch the cutscene. Papa, we haven't started the ritual yet. Dad's not here right now. Oh, right. I'll start preparing the ritual. Go find Leon Bamoon. The black and gold dragonborn chuckles. I think you're getting forgetful in your old age. Leiden, don't test me. Reuben starts walking towards the right. Papa, they're that way? Leiden points in the opposite direction. Oh, right. Reuben turns around and starts heading towards the left. Leiden chuckles and shakes his head. Krebus enters the room with the bodies and stops and stares at his resting husband. I found this book on the spell plague. Apparently, the god of magic, Mistra, was killed, and it ripped the weave and caused magic to go wild, and there was a storm of blue flames that decimated wherever it spread. It wasn't until Mistra was reborn that everything settled down. It was fascinating. Krebus looks over at the young voice to see a dragonborn child talking to Cyrus's body. "Hello, little one." The child yips and quickly turns to Krebus. "Krebus, you're back!" The child rushes up and hugs Krebus's legs. "Himen?" The child releases her grasp from his leg and nods. "Mm-hmm. Is Layden with you? I know he went after you. I decided to hold down the fort. I think I have everything set up for the ritual as Leon instructed." She kind of looks around, just making sure everything was right. "Like, can I watch? I may not be able to do this in the future, but I want to have an idea of how it works. I'll stay out of the way and quiet." Krebus sits down his sack and examines the chamber. Walking around, looking at the positioning of the ritual components. Lemon stands patiently at the door, wringing her hands. Krebus nods. "Oh, well done. I think you're missing a component," and he points at the sack he set down. Lemon goes over to the sack, gestures for permission to open it. Krebus nods, and Lemon opens it, and her eyes widen.
"Wow, that's a lot of diamonds.
If you set this up, you'll know what to do with those." Lemon turns back, smiling with excitement to see Krebus standing next to Krebus' body, his expression sad and solemn. Her smile fades.
"Krebus? How long were you actually gone?"
"1,000 years. Lemon turns around to see the tall black and gold dragonborn entering the room. Krebus looks to Layden, nods, and returns his gaze to Kriv, reaching out to hold Kriv's hand. Layden kneels down next to his sister. "Eunice, Kel, and Yaros were being held by someone we had to hunt down. It was taken care of, but she was hard to find." He pulls a pocket watch from his belt. "Fort, let me take this pocket watch. Shows us the date and time here while we traveled. Plan on getting back here within a day if we hadn't even found her by then, but
I remember the planes we traveled. Time was weird and things started going backwards and forwards, so we kind of didn't lose any time here in the material plane. I think we spent a few years in the Feywild for a few minutes here when we noticed it showed time went back a few years. Women hugs her brothers. Must have been hard. Aiden hugs her back. It was. Talk about this later. Why don't you talk about this? Why don't you two talk about this now? Two dragons look to the doorway to see Leon. It is standing there. Aiden stands up and holds out a hand for his sister. She takes it and nods to Leon. You leave the room, and Leon approaches Krebus. You're looking young for your age, Krebus. Honestly? I didn't even notice the time go by. After checking with Layden a few times, I stopped asking. Best friends were being held by that bitch, Baba Yaga. I was angry. Never stopped being angry the whole time. Tired. I'm tired of being angry. Tears start forming in Krebus's eyes. I don't even know why I hadn't died of old age, or why I don't seem to have aged a day. Krebus turns to Leon. Despite my appearance, I feel the age, though. Aiden still picks on me for being old. He's an ancient dragon now. Hell, I wouldn't be surprised if he's as big as his dad in his original form. Krebus unhooks Eye's Will from his harness. Suppose I should return this to you. Leon puts a hand up to stop him. Keep it. It actually may be what's sustaining you. Besides, he closes his hand around a similar warhammer that appears in front of him. The avatars of Io, we don't just wield a weapon, but Io's will itself. The warhammer is just a manifestation of it. I'm sure Io felt your rage through your clarion call, gave you the life of a dragon. I don't feel like a dragon. You're not actually a dragon, but you'll live as long as one. Leon and Krebus stow their weapons. Leon puts a hand on Krebus' shoulder. Come on, old man. Why don't you get some rest and let Kasota set everything up? We can complete the ritual when you've rested. Leon wraps his arm around Krebus and guides him out of the room. We will bring Griff back to you. So, Squall, Fitch, Percy, Eddie. There's some commotion at the eyes by Io. You see a brand new black and gold dragonborn walking around with the one that you think was named Lemon? Or was it Kasota? It gets kind of confusing. People keep calling her something different. You also see that Krebus has returned. There's something different about him. He seems to be moving more like an old man, but he looks the same like the last time you saw him.
Paul just raised his hand and be like, did I miss something? Like, did I? I just went to bed. Well, let's see what time. Okay, I took a nap. And then all this is going on. He says nap because he didn't sleep all throughout the night. Because, yeah, him and Jordan are really hitting cops.
Yeah. Jordan's patron's feelings. She's a friend to Eros, but this is just weird to her. Devosa is just like, never mind, it's fine.
Yeah, he's just going to try to figure out what's going on, and now that he's hearing all this commotion.
Mm-hmm.
Bitch will, kinda walk around and investigate, but...
I'll be there in a minute.
Not really investigating, like, half-heartedly investigating what's going on.
Just kind of observing.
Yeah.
Just being like, huh? What's Percy doing?
Percy.
Probably just chilling. I don't know. Honestly.
Just whatever.
He's on the beach. Trying to get a tan.
He's like, I did my job, I'm done.
You guys got a nice reward.
Yeah.
During brunch time, because I'm sure there's like mimosas and a bunch of brunchy stuff in the dining room.
Yes.
The lemon and lemon comes up to Krebus and says, I'm done with my preparations. I can watch, right? Yeah. Let me check on it. And you see Krebus. He doesn't look. He looks the same as you've seen him before, but the way he gets up, it looks like he's like some sort of old man doing that careful standing up. And Layden and this black and gold dragonborn, who you seen, it goes, yep, I'm coming. You see the gold paladin Bamoon and the copper cleric Leon. I'll follow them out of the room. It's time. And they start heading toward the chamber. Do you follow?
Yes.
Yes.
Because I am very curious on what the hell's going on.
Krebus is this entire time. Lemon has actually taken Krebus's hand and is walking with him towards the chamber where the bodies are. And he enters the room and looks around, and you see on the biers that the tables that the bodies are lying on, each of them has lined around the table just this perfectly set line of diamonds. And this is around all 10 bodies. Leon goes to the opposite side of the chamber, and Krebus steps up to a altar that's on his that's just inside the door. The Moon and Layden go to either side. Layden starts indicating to people where they can stand and watch, and Isota takes up position near Cyrus.
Okay,
and
here.
And Krebus and Leon take out Ion's will, and they put the handle into, they slide it into a hold that's in the altars that are in front of them, and it just ends up squarely fitting right there with the head just right on top of the altar. And as if in sync, they both put their hands over the head of the Warhammers, and they start saying some words. Words, and these tendrils of energy in various different colors start streaming out. Bamoon and Layden put out their hands and reach out, and it seems like they're guiding their side of the tendrils that are going, that are arcing out and converging them in the center. They start muttering some words as well, and the energies start to go from these lines of energy to more of a mist, and they spread out across all the bodies, and Krebus and Leon at the same time reach it down their hand, and they like bring it up like they're doing like rise, like some sort of rising motion. The bodies on the tables just seem to hover a little, and the diamonds that are on their tables rise with them. And all of a sudden, there's like some sparking motions, and the diamonds shatter. And this glowing energy absorbs into each of the bodies. Kethrick, you feel a tug. You look over at Fang, and he smiles at you and nods. You are being called home. Do you answer?
Yes, this is farewell. Thanks for having me.
Before you can say that whole thing, you say thanks, and to him, you fade away. Frederica.
Yes.
You're discussing stuff with Chitant or and maybe having some food at the table near the Dragon Launch. When you feel a tug. And Chitant's eyes widen and says,
I think it's
done. I'll see you. See you in a sec. And you both fade away from there as Vaxeldon launches. Kriv, what would you be doing in Mount Celestia? After Cyrus is currently probably in the library.
I'd probably actually be out in the garden looking out on the plain. Just contemplating everything that's happened since the beginning of the adventure.
You
and coming to some realizations.
You hear the sound of a familiar set of wings as Bahamut lands next to you, and he looks to you, and you feel it. I believe you are being called, and you do feel this tug.
I do.
And do you answer?
I will. But I think my adventure is over. I will live my life down there. I need to be there for Krebus and not out gallivanting across the realms.
Then farewell.
I almost lost them once.
Very well. And I will see you. And you fade out. Cyrus, I'm assuming you're currently busy, like, in books.
I like to imagine just all of the library in the secret lair is just spontaneously having new books pop up.
No one... Yeah, that's probably what's happening. The only thing is that no one notices because no one's in there.
Exactly.
Right now. So When Lemon goes in there to kind of like check on it, because she's basically been like the keeper of this lair while you've been away, she'll be a little bit surprised. But you feel this tug, and you hear this little whisper. Daddy, please come home. And it's a familiar sound of Lemon.
He definitely perk up at that and
answer the call.
Yeah, he would. He has to.
So much more books to read.
Exactly.
Three more books, but I gotta go to my child. Later.
This decision is tougher than it should be.
Books, child.
The thing is, you start thinking of that, but you already know your answer it in your heart. So you start fading away from the library, and the book falls to the ground. Safe. It just falls to the ground. It's not like, it doesn't do any damage to the book.
It falls, pages open, and it's like slowly damaging the spine.
No. Actually, as he does that, there's actually a pseudo dragon, which is one of the library assistants, comes up and quickly catches it and takes it back to where it's supposed to go. and he fades. Kriv, Cyrus, Frederica, Catherick, you're tired again. You're like, you have this feeling, it's like, I was just like this, like just like an hour ago. Why do I feel this way? But the Percy, Squall, Eddie, Fitch, you watch as the blue dragonborn, the blue woman, the elephant man, the mini dragon, and the half orc, the Asmar, the human? Question mark, and the actual human start breathing.
Oh no, but Wim.
And the dragon, and the black dragon.
Wim, if you want, you can say the race of the changeling, though. When they die, they revert to their original form.
Okay, so and the changeling start to breathe. So the only thing is that one does not. The human paladin,
half elf,
remains a half elf paladin. Paladin doesn't seem to have answered the call.
Is that Gizli?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. Fitch raises his hand. One of them weren't breathing. If anyone cares, like,
right. He must have wanted to stay where he was.
Lady goes over and says, and lays his hand and says, "It seems like he's at peace. And we'll make sure that he rests. I think his vengeance may have been satiated."
Who are you?
Oh, me? I'm Layden. It's been a while. Well, not very long for you, but quite a long time for me.
Wait, what? Layden? What? How'd you...
Oh.
I saw you. You were just a...
Yeah, it's yeah, well, you see, we found out that, like, those three, any points to the changeling, Asimar, and human, the other human, Deonis, Kel, and Yaros over there, well, they are being held by this very powerful witch known as Baba Yaga. She's really hard to find, especially when she doesn't want to be found. And so I actually spent about 1,000 years looking for her. We did get a little help from her daughter, Tasha. And actually that was just before we found her. So Tasha was a huge help. That Papa was really persuasive. But we killed her. Papa got some memories back. And in any case, I'm now an ancient dragon, so that's why I can easily change shape like this.
Ah! Oh my god.
Craig will just run up and just hug Layden, just like, I am so sorry for all of this.
I was like, all right, daddy. You try to get up, but you are so stiff. You also, as you put up your hand to touch Layden, you notice your scales aren't blue. They're gold.
Just stare at my hand. Just in awe. But then go back, like, kind of like, worry about this later, and just my family.
You see over by over at the front of the room, you see Krebus with his head down. He looks tired. He looks up and he smiles, but he looks exhausted.
What happened?
Welcome home, honey. And he kind of like, he doesn't look like he's aged at all, but he seems to like moving so slowly, like exhausted, like he's aching almost. And he comes over and he says, now calling you Goldie is more accurate. And he caresses your face and gives you a big old kiss and hug. And he and you fall over onto the table because he kind of like exhaustedly just falls on you.
I have you on. I think it's time for us to take a break.
Yeah, I understand. Oh, sorry. You see, Cyrus. As soon as you open your eyes. You see this dragonborn child, which you realize to be the polymorphed version of your sweet baby, Lemon, come up to you and say, Daddy! And she gives you a big old hug.
I give her a huge hug back.
She gives you the hug and she just makes sure it's like, you must be exhausted from the ritual. I studied it. This is a weird version of a resurrection ritual where like there's like 10 people are resurrected at the same time.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. When
you're just a little baby.
Well, I didn't do it. I didn't do it. I just helped. Leon told me what needed to be done for like the patient ritual components, and it had to do with like Krivis and Leon and Bamoon and Layden. Oh, by the way, Layden's an ancient dragon now.
What?
Apparently, Krivis's friends. I can't remember their name. Krivis's friends. They were being held by some sort of witch, and they traveled to the plains, but time was all like weird and such. Well, they were only planning on just like, they were just going to make sure that if anything, it would just be back the next day so that they could perform the ritual no matter what. They actually ended up spending 1,000 years traveling the plains looking for her, and they found her, and they got their souls back and everything. But now Krebus and Leda are now like 1,000 years old. Older.
Oh my.
Yeah. I went on a ride. Layden took me for a ride. It was kind of fun. Because he flies faster than me now. But he's also much larger than me, so. Oh, the Keeper of the Tomes at Candlekeep, he gave me this. And she holds up this little talisman, which has some arcane symbols on it. And says, it allows me to polymorph. I mean, only into, like, an age-appropriate dragon, black dragonborn. I don't care. It just makes things a little bit easier. I asked him if I could get you one, because I know, like, don't get me wrong, like you being mini dragon and such, if you would like want to be more in a humanoid form, that it might be nice. But he said no. This was really more like the payment for all the help that I've done in Candlekeep while you guys were gone.
Oh, I'm glad. That makes me happy.
They like me there.
That's perfect.
I've kept made sure. All these new people around here, they help to save your souls. I made sure that no one knew about the bad artifacts that were in the vault, but they did use some of the good ones.
Okay, perfect. That's good.
Yeah, I also placed the Breath of the Queen in there, but no one would find it.
Okay. That's very smart of you. I'm very proud of you. I'm so happy to see you again. And I'll give her another really big hug.
Yeah, she continues to give you a hug.
So, sister is probably going to be going over her boy.
Yeah, it's pretty much you both woke up and kind of instinctively looked in each other's directions. And you're just on tables right next to each other. Each other says, "Hey, Mama."
We're alive. We're there.
We're back. Hold on. He transforms, because he was in his dragon form. He transforms back into his boy form and slowly gets off the table. He's like wobbly. Whoa, this is weird.
What is weird?
Well, I'm actually in a physical body now, and I need to get used to it again. It's just gotta take a moment. It's like a little dizzy sort of thing.
I know you said Layden is not gonna brag or anything. Probably that with Layden being all grown up, he might say something. But that's going to be it for sister for now.
Kind of more of a resolution of the form.
Do we have our memories of our afterlife?
Yes. You remembered everything that happened.
Fitch would be eyeing everyone that just came back to life, trying to like size up their worth and like what was the point of all of this.
You do see Layden, after seeing his dad start like practically pass out, because there's resurrecting is a tiring experience, not just for the caster as much, but for the resurrectee. So I'm assuming Kriv and Kribus kind of like they're having a moment and probably like semi dozing on the beer together. Yeah. And Layden comes over to Zindralov, who is just getting up and looking around, and he's smiling at the people awake and says, "Zindralov, how are you doing?"
Layden. You've grown.
Yeah. Quite a bit. How are you feeling?
Tired? Need some rest, but... Well, we didn't miss the council session, did we?
No. That won't be until tomorrow. In the meantime, rest up. I can help you to your room if you'd like.
Yeah, absolutely. Is he?
And the elephant myth steps off the beer and walks over to where Gisli's body is. And lays his hand on him.
And may you rest in peace.
We're going to make sure his death is not in vain.
He takes a... He does a few of his own rites of Eldath over him. He says,
Everybody who has resurrected, please go to your rooms and rest. We have a council meeting tomorrow. I see we have some new faces.
Before everyone goes off, Fitch would use a divine sense.
You would sense celestial blood coming from the Asimar. And you would sense some sort of celestial presence coming from Kribus and Leon. That's about it.
Okay.
And Layden actually... As Zindralov starts heading out of the room, he kind of seems to wobble, and Layden actually comes over and kind of like helps escort him out of the room. Yeah, okay, kind of. Layden seems really strong for some reason.
It's like he's
grown up. Kribus was like, oh, after spending 1,000 years trying to hunt down a witch to save my friends. Yeah, he's grown quite a bit. Be surprised.
It's just like, not sure about that council meeting. I'm done with these adventures.
Yes.
Well, I hate to say it, but I can't be. I mean, I'm not going to be going out in the field or anything.
That's what I think. We might just help.
You'd stick around here. Yeah. You need to.
I almost lost you once due to some of my actions. I can't end it.
Well, Layden wouldn't want to give up the fight, that's for sure. We've talked about it a few times, several times while we were out.
We'll find a way to help these people out. Not in the
future. So, you went to Mount Celestia?
Yeah.
So,
yeah, actually.
Mm-hmm.
He actually said he was proud of me.
I knew it.
I guess that's why I am the way I am now.
Yeah, people will now understand why I called you Goldie.
Yeah.
Well, I'm here for whatever you want to do. But, although I still want to probably stick around here, if the word is that they may be going home soon. Leon, Bamoon. They're going to leave us here. And you're welcome to take up residence.
Nice place. We can still be of use to the group. Even if our patrons aren't here anymore.
Yeah, well.
Who knows what we'll find here.
I mean, you could just pretty much say they're the eyes vile, vile drone. We be the eyes vile. Well, here on.
Oh.
Here on Toro.
I like that.
Let's
I mean,
go sleep, Tant.
Yes, Mama. You two head off. Leon approaches your four others characters. Says, well, we thank you for your assistance for what you've done. If you are willing, you can join us on a quest, because it seems like at least a couple of them are not staying with us. We are currently in the pursuit of stopping Tiamat's return from the Toro. I believe we still have one more council session that they need to attend to. But we'd be willing to pay you, of course, if you wish to stick around. My team will be leaving soon here, but Krebus and Quart and Lifter will still be around here to be your patrons. If you choose to continue on this journey. But
Krebus, Quartz, and who?
Lifter. Lifter is the Warforged that works with Quart. Basically, he says, you helped us in our current endeavor. We have a much larger endeavor that we're about to, that this group is for. If you would wish to be part of that, you are welcome. But which may provide some further rewards. But he does not require you to.
Squall would just be like, well, my benefactor really hasn't said if my job is done or not yet, so I'm assuming it's not. It's normally I'm kind of told when things are done. When I've completed my favor, they ask of me. So, I guess I don't know.
You see a familiar brown orc in there. There's Leah, and I'm going to be sticking around too. I believe Devosa wants me to stay to keep Eris's minion in check. And he gives you a wink.
Minion? Ah!
Like, he gives you a wink and a grin, like he's just like
playing with me. Yeah. I just don't go along with it. Just, minion, I would never. Yeah, you're right.
Well, the wind hasn't told me where to go yet, so that must mean I'm exactly where it needs me to be. I'll be staying.
Bitch would say, feel like my my expertise, let's just say for the lack of a word at the moment, would be better suited out and about finding, I don't know, the hands of Tiamat. So I'm gonna head out.
Well, you're always welcome here. Fighting
alongside you.
Sure.
If
my help is needed in any way, of course I'll be willing to help. You just gotta find me. I won't be hiding.
If you wish, Quart will be able to provide you with the sending stone, which will allow you to allow us to communicate with you and communicate with us in case you need some assistance on your own. Yeah, I think I need to hire a few people. I need someone like Sylvia. I don't suppose I can borrow Sylvia here too, or should I find somebody from Toral here? Sylvia says, I must return to him. I apologize. I think I have some ideas for someone who might be able to, might be willing to join you. I'll go check on them before we leave. And Sylvia exits the room. Basically, they're making sure that if Krebus is going to be ahead of the Eyes of Io of Toral, he's going to have a team. He's going to have a team helping him out. That reminds me. While I will be staying to make sure that everything's all hunky-dory here, I may actually have to see about finding somebody to stay around, someone who would actually be more of a permanent person for you. So basically, he starts work on the Eldronian Eyes of Io starts work on helping Krebus develop his own group of Eyes of Io on Toral.
He has Crib.
Griff, you're my baboon.
Oh.
And gives you another kiss. Percy. Unmute.
There we go. I was muted because I was brushing my teeth.
What is Percy doing?
I honestly think he kind of just was doing all of this just for something to do.
He got another nice reward from it.
Yeah, make a name for himself. So,
big ass reward.
Yeah, I think he would probably want. I think he probably just wants to keep using. He would probably just end up using the reward and such that he got to help kind of broaden his horizons. He would use it to adventure more and explore some more. Kind of,
but probably not with this group.
Yeah, probably not. He likes everybody, but it's still, he's a solo act, if that's a way of putting it.
He's a traveling bard rogue.
Yeah, that's a pirate man. He cannot be tamed.
He has some booty to pirate.
I'm assuming you say goodbye to your barbarian buddy.
I would ask him to join me.
Barbarian booty? This is. Sorry, I gotta go back to Iodron with the rest of these.
All right, fine. I guess it's accepted.
Besides, I thought we were on the same page. We were just fucking.
Oh, damn.
I mean, yeah, it's, you know, like, can I get you in a, you know, dick to go box?
Well, I'm not leaving just this moment. He grabs her hand and says, come on.
Horny bard things. It's how it be.
Horny bard and barbarian. With this, every single one of the characters levels to 13.
Yay! Woohoo!
So there was essentially, when I had to create your new characters at level 12, that was the milestone for that. With the resolution of this, it gains another level.
Yeah.
Although, you might not get a level for a little while because of the way the story goes, because you probably are a level ahead.
That's okay. Okay.
Hey, so,
four.
We all got gold, our new characters.
Mm-hmm.
What happens to that gold if our new characters are leaving? Do they just keep that gold?
Yeah, it's their gold.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Fitch has a lot of gold and platinum.
Yeah.
Percy has a lot of gold and platinum. Eddie has a lot of gold and platinum.
Okay. So I'm not metagaming.
Yeah, that's okay. We're currently out of character.
Yeah. Percy would probably give a decent portion of his money to the group. Because he's already a noble. He's already comes from a wealthy background. He doesn't need it.
Besides, you know? It's probably fucking heavy.
Don't worry, yeah. Quirk can give you a every keep coin keeper. It's like a bag of holding, but for strictly for coins.
Yeah,
and the capacity is not measured in weight or volume, but it's measured in worth of coinage. I want to say it's like several thousand platinum pieces worth of coins.
Before
which is a lot.
Leaves, he will give back the battle plate, pretty much both of his relics or whatever they're called, artifacts.
Yeah, any artifacts that you borrowed are essentially returned.
Percy that... really, really wants to keep his harp.
Yeah, you're probably going to return that because Yaros will want it back.
I'm hoping I can keep the Cloak of Displacement and Dragon Slayer Greatsword.
Yep. Cool. Those you can keep. It's just anything of artifacts or borrowed from one of the borrowed from the equipment of somebody else. And if there is anything that you essentially borrow that's less than but that's rare quality or less, Court would be essentially be a free replacement. Oh, here we go. So Quartz Everkeep Coin Keeper is a leather drawstring pouch, has a interior space considerably larger than its outside dimensions. Even Quart himself doesn't know the actual dimensions. The pouch's opening is no more than 3 inches in diameter and looks like a pouch 4 or 5 inches deep, partially filled with coins. The pouch jiggles when you shake it, even when the bag is empty. The pouch can hold up to 10,000 platinum pieces worth of coins. That's 100,000 gold pieces, by the way. No matter what type of coin is placed in the bag, the pouch weighs 1 pound regardless of its contents. Retrieving an item from the pouch requires an action. The pouch can be magically bound to an article of clothing, such as a belt. Should the pouch ever be more than 50 feet from the article that it's bound to, the pouch will magically teleport to the article and attach itself. The pouch may also be bound to a person so that only that person can open the pouch. These are bindings, not attunements. So they don't take up attunement slots.
Woohoo!
So, Squall will have to give back the rod of the pack keeper plus 3, but yep. I have the pet for plus 2. Hold on.
Placing a coin keeper inside an extra-dimensional space created by a bag of holding, a handy haversack, portable hole, or similar item instantly destroys both items and opens a gate to the astral plane. The gate originates where the one item was placed inside the other. Any creature within 10 feet of the gate is sucked through to a random location on the astral plane. The gate then closes. The gate is one way only and can't.
Fancy dancy.
So if you want a Everkeep coin keeper, you're very welcome to have one.
I'm now on the quest to find a robe of the Archmagi.
You'll have to fight Cyrus for that one.
What if you find two?
Yeah.
Ooh.
That'd be great for Squall.
All right, so Who is our party now?
Cyrus.
Squall.
Sister and Shutant.
Ethric.
And then Zindralov.
Yeah. And Hopper is going to be around if they need it. If he's getting called somewhere else, that's where he's going to go.
Okay.
Basically.
Yeah, I'll let you figure that out. Okay. Maybe you've essentially become an agent of the Eyes of Io of Toril.
Yeah, he doesn't mind about that.
Anybody who's not sticking around is welcome to take a sending stone to communicate with the Eyes of Io of Toril. And you have a place to stay that's not inside Waterdeep, that's kind of isolated, and basically has a place where no one can really scry on you.
Woohoo!
Welcome to the Sanctum of Eyes.
I'm just like, wait, why do I have, like, why is my weight so much? I have, like, 1,833 pounds. I'm like, oh, yeah, I have a shit ton of gold right now. Oh, and he does not have a horse.
Yeah, you can get that easily.
What's it called again?
Quartz Everkeep Coin Keeper. I'll put it in the Discord chat. I mean, when you actually like put that on yourself, it doesn't actually minus the weight. So you would basically have to customize it to be a negative value of the weight of your coins, minus one.
How much do coins weigh?
5 pounds each gold piece. No, of course not.
Actually, I think there's a setting in the settings if you go into
to ignore coin weight.
To ignore coin weight. Yeah, 50 coins weighs 1 pound. Yeah, ignore coin weight.
And I changed up my implications.
Because of this ordeal, if you feel like you need class changes or anything like that, based off of your experiences, you're welcome to do that. I know somebody wants to do that.
What else to change?
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
With the new way Shutant is gonna act, can I steer him more towards the Raven Queen?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
I mean, if he has, because he's had experience essentially directly with the Raven Queen, and she. Between his interactions with Raven Chorus and the Raven Queen, he still has his little thiefy, you know, personality. Again, the good natured thiefy personality, very still roguish, but he understands that if anything, this will be where he goes in his afterlife. So he'll have this little inkling of faith, you could say. So even if he comes like a rogue paladin, rogue paladin of the Raven Queen, that hasn't been done before.
I don't mind about that. I could see it go there, but if you're okay with it, I would change his subclass for the Phantom, which goes more for the dead, for the Raven Queen.
Sure. Thematically speaking, that seems appropriate. If he has any questions, he can speak to Cal.
Okay.
I could change my pack to the talisman to pack to the chain.
Yep.
Technically, Kethrick has died a virgin.
Oh, wow. there's a few people currently in the room that can help you with that.
Kethrick would not do any of that. Not because he wants to, just because that requires interaction.
That he's just not quite comfortable with.
So yeah, I'm like, now I gotta figure out what my familiar would be. What a gaining patient familiar would be.
You could talk to Jordan about that. But you know that he's more fond of the pseudo dragon.
Oh well, no, it makes a lot of sense. Wind. The level 13 of the Phantom is called Ghost Walk. You can phase partially into the realm of the dead, becoming like a ghost. As a bonus action, you assume a spectral form. While in this form, you have flying speed of 10 feet, whatever, and you can pass through people, and attacks roll against you has disadvantage. Just the phasing into the realm of the Raven Queen makes sense. Yeah, that's pretty it.
I think there should be another boon that the taunt gets, which I think we can do by feet.
Shadow touch?
No. Slightly different.
Okay.
Because of his Incarnum heritage and his current experience, I would say that Reverend Koros probably also taught him how to soul mill.
Oh, yes.
Do you by any chance have access to the Magic of Incarnum book from 3.5?
I'm sorry.
You're testing, it's fine. So would you like to reveal your Catherick's major change?
He is now a rogue.
We're having so many rogues.
So I got a spell sniper.
That's perfect. We have a melee rogue and a long range rogue.
Yeah, are you still going to be doing like the range, or are you going to be like getting up in people's faces with daggers?
Range.
Okay.
Definitely range. Okay. My archetype is actually scout.
Oh,
nice. Okay. That's just better ranger.
Yeah, and you're able to with that you can still use longbows.
Uh-huh.
Okay. So you can still use fenters.
One of the invocations they took is Gift of the Ever-Living One. So as long as my familiar is within 100 feet of me, whenever I get healed, I treat any dice roll to determine the hit points I regain as rolling the maximum value.
Nice.
Apparently. Whenever I roll a ability check that adds my proficiency bonus, if I roll below a 9, I can treat it as a 10.
I saw something about that. Was that another one of my applications? I thought I can do that too. Or is that crypt? I leveled up Crib to 13 just in case he decides to make an appearance again. And changed him to gold.
He could do an appearance at the end.
Yeah. It was like, if I'll keep him, like, his character sheet leveled appropriately in case he ever decides to make an appearance.
Yeah. Anybody who is going to be, like, present but not part of the party... and maybe considered agents of IO, of the Eyes of IO, they would essentially be doing like separate adventures off. We might even be able to use them that if we don't have as many people, we can at least have a moment where we take some time with them. And go on some mini adventures with them as well.
Oh, that's a good one to get later on. Voice the Chainmaster. No matter how far away I am from my familiar, I can talk to them and perceive through their senses. As long as we're on the same plane of existence.
Whenever I play as Fitch, I have my own little backstory for Fitch, by the way.
That's perfectly fine. This is D&D.
Yeah. But whenever I play as Fitch and he has Mind Steed spell, I always make the horse giant. Fitch was actually my first character that I didn't have help with building.
Nice. Yeah, for me with building characters, I always just like I look at like the basic. I use the guide that's in the PHP to kind of determine where like priority of numbers to go to, and then I think more along the lines of character than optimization, because that's more fun.
Yeah, it's always fun to choose stuff that you think your character would do, because like a lot of my spells, like for Squall, a lot of his like deal with doing stuff for damage, but like some of them for a little bit like had like hallucinatory terrain. That's also he used to do for the show. And stuff, so it's kind of like had dual purpose.
Like a Krebus, I definitely wanted a negative number for his modifier. I actually wanted his intelligence to be as low as possible. Which didn't help when I was when we ended up in the campaign where the only intelligent person ended up being somebody who ended up leaving and was a bastard. Anyways, the character was a bastard. That player. And he ended up leaving, so the intelligence of Krubus's original party is actually kind of low. I'm gonna say it's a little.
I'll be right back.
All right. Boy. Yes. And so when Boy was off and Ravencore's taught him about soul melding. He's able to use soul energy to create this kind of like blue energy bracers. They don't take up an attunement slot or anything. In fact, they don't even take up an equipment slot. They just kind of like appear around his arms. With this... Okay. With this, he gains the alert feat.
Nice.
Yeah. These are referred to as blue steel bracers. Oh, yeah. I know where that comes from. The original blue steel bracers gave a plus two insight bonus to his initiative checks, but they don't exist in 3E, so that's the workaround. But I actually think, mainly because it's kind of like one of those things where it's a lot of RP and just hanging out and leveling characters.
Yep.
I think we will call it for today. And because we're scheduling's been weird right now, we'll continue to figure out what the next step is. But level 13, everybody, the next session we will actually go into the Council of Waterdeep. And Krubus and Leon will probably will have gone off and discussed that the original Izvayo are leaving, but Jordan and Court and Lifter from the original are sticking around for a little while. And that Krubus is basically taking up the spot of Leon being the head of the patronage.
Not sure what implications to take.
And I think you've got a lot. All of you have some, or some of you have a lot they need to do, just making decisions for some of their characters. So,
yeah, I'm just figuring out implications now.
So, but we'll leave it.
What is he going to do with so much gold?
Yeah,
Rick has 5 gold.
Yeah, that's a one thing. Percy will have to figure out how much he's giving to the Eyes of Io or to the Pyre of Faith, essentially. That could be how it would end up being distributed. Yeah, because I'm assuming Percy's going to give still keep a good chunk of the money that he got.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
He's just making a charitable donation. Because he's noble, of course. He's such a philanthropist that he's going to give
a donation. No, he's not a philanthropist. It's just the case of, I don't need this. It's too much. I don't need it.
What a strange noble.
At home. I don't need this.
Oh, see... Squall will take it all. He's an orphan, so
Well, so is Percy. I'm joking. I'm.
Yeah, technically Percy's an orphan. He was adopted by some people in Waterdeep.
Yeah.
Oh, that didn't happen to Squall.
Anyways.
Anyways, I do need to do the head out.
Okay.
But it was really fun playing with you guys again. Sorry about this morning.
It's all good.
Keep discussing.
So are we doing Thursday this coming week or Sunday? Just so we all are here in understanding.
Thursday.
Thursday.
Okay.
Thursday this week? Okay.
Thursday,
7:30.
This is...
All right.
For the moment, we're catch up.
Yeah.
Sounds good. All right, I will talk to you guys later.
Bye.